On December 19th, 2008, Tim DeChristopher disrupted a highly disputed auction for mining and oil rights near canyon lands and arches. And as one who has hiked in that country with my husband, I can tell you it's an incredibly gorgeous place. He bid something like $1.7 million, which he did not have, to buy parcels of land, which shouldn't have been on the auction block in the first place. And for those 22,000 acres of land that he supposedly bought, he served 21 months in prison. When he got out of prison, he entered Harvard Divinity School, and he's gone there for the first two out of the 3 years to earn a Doctor of Divinity in Masters, and to become a Unitarian Universalist minister. And this year he's taking off to work on climate justice issues full time. And then next year he'll continue at Harvard. He has been instrumental in starting climate justice group in Salt Lake City, Utah, and more recently, the Climate Disobedience Center. And you're going to hear more about that from him when he speaks tonight. So, Tim, welcome. I'm just so glad you are here.
Thank you all for being here. It's great to see a lot of people show up tonight. Half an hour or so ago, I was ready to just kind of fall asleep in the back of the church back there because it's been a really, really big week for me. But seeing you all here tonight, I'm feeling re-energized. So maybe by like halfway through my talk, I'll start to get a little fired up, feeling the energy from you guys that feeding me right now. It's kind of what I need to keep me going. And it's been a big week for me because this week was the culmination of something that I have been waiting for a very long time and something that I've been working for a very long time. Back when I disrupted that Bureau of Land Management oil and gas auction at the end of 2008, a big part of my intention was to be able to make the case that that kind of action was necessary because of the urgency of climate change and the inadequacy of our government's response to it. I was inspired by some folks in the UK called the King's North Six who were able to make that case when they shut down a coal-fired power plant. And they were able to present what's called the necessity defense, the argument that they were acting out of necessity to prevent a greater harm from climate change. And I thought, that's exactly what we need. And so after I took my action, that's the kind of defense that I wanted to make. But I was very much shut down in being able to make that defense. I had a very ideological judge who had only become a judge because he had been the chief of staff to Senator Orrin Hatch and was appointed directly to the federal bench from Orrin Hatch's office because Hatch has so much power on the Judiciary Committee. And so he made it clear where he stood, and he said there will be no discussion of climate change whatsoever in my courtroom. And so that was part of why I got convicted and spent 2 years in prison, which gave me lots and lots of time to think about what could happen with a climate necessity defense trial and to think about what it would look like to be able to present that full defense in a courtroom and how to make the most of that opportunity. I sat in prison for 2 years and thought about that, and then got out of prison and started organizing with more folks to try to make that happen, and found some other folks who were approaching civil disobedience in a creative and principled way when I moved out to Massachusetts, and together we formed the Climate Disobedience Center to support other activists who are engaging in civil disobedience around climate change, to try to help folks realize the full potential of civil disobedience. At the time, I felt like in the climate movement, there's been more and more of an embrace of civil disobedience to some extent. But far too much of that has been a photo op style civil disobedience, where it's arranged with the cops beforehand that if you stand in this little box, that they will give you 3 warnings, and then they'll come and they'll put handcuffs on you and they'll take you to the station. You'll be given a $100 citation, and you pay that, and you go home and you read about it in the paper the next day. That's not entirely useless, but I also think it's not realizing that full powerful potential that civil disobedience has. It's not realizing that potential that has made civil disobedience such a core part of so many of our successful social movements in our history. I felt that there was much more to be realized, not just in the action itself, but in realizing that the action doesn't end at the point when someone gets arrested, that there's a lot more opportunity to leverage that action for greater social change. And so when I heard about the Delta 5 activists out here in Seattle that had blockaded an oil train and wanted to take their case to trial and wanted to use the necessity defense, I jumped at the chance to get involved and to support them, and have been working with them for the past few months, and came out here this week with the other folks from the Climate Disobedience Center and sat at that courtroom in Linwood all week, and it was so incredibly moving for me. There was a point when the first defendant took the stand, and I just got choked up watching it, because I realized that this was what I had been waiting for 7 years, and what I had been working so hard to try to realize for 7 years was actually happening. That in an American courtroom, activists were presenting the full case for how serious the climate crisis is, how much our government has entirely failed to address that crisis, and how powerful people can be when they step up to their responsibility to stand in the way of the fossil fuel industry. And for 3 days, we heard tremendous testimony, not only from the 5 defendants about all of their motivations and all of the things that they had tried to affect change within the system. We also heard from expert witnesses, from climate scientists, from oil safety experts, from railroad experts, from a railroad whistleblower who got fired from the BNSF for reporting safety violations. We heard all this testimony about the urgency of the climate crisis, the massive impacts that we're facing, the way that our civilization is hanging in the balance. We heard about the direct impacts that communities are facing from these bomb trains that are rolling through communities in completely unprecedented ways. Far bigger trains, far more explosive, far more dangerous. And we also heard about the money in politics that is preventing actual solutions. When Patrick was able to be on the stand and talk about the Exxon New revelations, to talk about how Exxon knew from the 1970s about climate change, that they knew that there was a scientific consensus, and then in the 80s they started denying it and created a whole denial machine to corrupt our government. We're able to talk about how broken that governmental system is, how much corporations have an oversized influence over our democratic processes, and why just working within that system on its own is never going to be enough to address these crises that we face. This was phenomenal to see, and it was unprecedented for activists to be able to put on that kind of defense. And I think when we look at it coherently over the first few days of that trial, it was the most comprehensive and coherent case for climate activism that's ever been presented in an American courtroom. And not only that, as somebody who works full-time on climate issues and who has been focused on this for a long time, reads a lot of stuff about this, studies a lot of stuff about this, talks to a lot of people about it, I actually think it was one of the most comprehensive and coherent cases for climate action that I've seen presented anywhere. And so that on its own is a tremendous resource. It's a tremendous resource to have all of that testimony put together for future activists who are going to be taking their case to court, because we know that it's going to take more of these actions. We know there's going to be more civil disobedience against all the planned fossil fuel infrastructure projects in the Northwest and throughout the rest of the country, right? Yeah. Okay. We have this tremendous resource for those activists. We also have it just for the general public to be able to connect these dots in the way that was done in that courtroom. That's a tremendous resource for us. And so we had this huge step forward by that point where all that testimony had been presented. And then things got a little weird. then it got to the point in the trial where the judge had to decide what jury instructions he was going to give to the jury. And so then he heard arguments from each side about whether or not he should give jury instructions about the necessity defense. And the necessity defense has four requirements, four standards that a defendant has to meet in order to even be able to present that defense. And the first standard is that there has to be a reasonable expectation of an imminent harm. And the second point is that harm has to be greater than the harm of whatever law they're breaking at the time. The third point, they have to have not created the harm that they're trying to avoid. And the fourth point is that there have to be no reasonable legal alternatives to breaking that law. And so the judge heard arguments on each side about this, and he said, these Delta 5 defendants, they are absolutely commendable in the way that they're living their lives and in the action that they're taking. And I think they're exemplary citizens who are acting morally, and we need more of them in our society to address these harms. And there's two of them right over there, Abby Brockway and Mike LaPointe, two of the Delta 5 defendants. And then the judge said, but. They're exemplary, they're moral, they're doing what's absolutely necessary, but there are these legal technicalities to which I am bound in my role as a judge and within this legal structure that I'm a part of. Oddly enough, he said this after having just heard several days of expert testimony about how our political and legal structures in this country are not adequate to address the crisis that we face. He had just heard experts talking about how these legal structures are not working. And then he said, here is what I know is moral. Here is what I know we need to avert the great harms that we are facing as a society. But the way that my legal system works over here requires me to stand in their way. So I'm going to do that. And he then denied the necessity defense, refused to give necessity defense instructions to the jury, refused to allow the defense team to present the necessity defense in their closing arguments and connect all those dots for the jury. And then the jury came back in the room and the judge said, now you need to disregard all of that expert testimony that you've heard for the last few days. It's completely inadmissible and you're not allowed to use it in making your decision. Basically, he was saying, don't think about the fact that your future is threatened, that your communities are under siege and your rights are being taken away and your democracy is broken. Don't think about any of that. He said, you have to follow these legal technicalities. Don't think about how your actions impact society. Don't think about the consequences of your actions, either for the defendants or for our world. Don't use ethics, don't use morals, don't use your conscience. Just look at what these legal standards say constitutes the elements of trespass and the elements of obstructing a train. And if you find that the facts in this case meet those elements, you have to convict. That is your job. So he presented this whole case that said, here's what I know is ethical. Here's what I know is legal. And I'm going to follow the laws of the system that I'm a part of. Which is something that was presented in a trial that looked at a major chapter of human history called the Nuremberg Trials. And what came out of those Nuremberg Trials is the Nuremberg Principles, which then became international law, that if you were being required in the legal system that you're a part of, if you're being required legally to do something that you know is unethical, that you know is inhumane, and puts other people at risk, you have a greater moral obligation and now a greater legal obligation through international law established by the Nuremberg Principle. You have a greater obligation to your fellow human beings than you do to that legal system. So that had been established long ago and entirely forgotten in the way that our legal system continues to operate today, and in the way that judge operated, and in the instructions that he gave to that jury. And so, you know, then things moved forward. The jury went to deliberate after hearing the closing arguments, came back the next morning with a little bit of an interesting verdict. They said not guilty on the charge of obstructing a train, but guilty on the charge of trespass. And that was an interesting and kind of unsuspected decision from them. You know, it was fantastic because the prosecution was trying to make the claim that these defendants had cost BNSF $10,000 by delaying trains. But they were acquitted of obstructing a train. So it wiped that off the table. So that right there was a victory. But again, that's when things got even weirder. Because then we took a recess before the sentencing part of the case, and the jurors were dismissed. They were told that they were no longer bound in their role as a juror, and they could talk about this case, they could leave, they could go home, do whatever. But some of them didn't go home. They stuck around, and they started talking with the defendants and started saying, thank you so much for what you did. Thank you for your action, and thank you for educating us this week. Our eyes were opened to this. We learned so much, and we don't want Washington to become a fossil fuel corridor. And they said, if there was any way that we felt like we could have acquitted you, we would have. And they said, you know, we were just looking for some way that we could have acquitted you. Which was odd because jurors are actually the highest level of our legal system, and there's no structure whatsoever that can second guess the decision that a jury makes in this country. They hold far more power than that judge held, but they didn't know it. They didn't understand that they held that power because the judge looks like a more powerful figure. There was this sort of latent power that they had that they didn't know that they had. And so they ended up not using it. And so then they were talking with the defendants some more, and Abby got them to agree to come to her next climate lobbying day. Two of them signed up with the Climate Disobedience Center to help us train future defendants. To help us train future defendants who are going on trial. and then three of them came back into the courtroom and sat down with the supporters to watch the sentencing part of the hearing. And so it was this this amazing conclusion that was completely unexpected. It was not at all the way that any of us had planned it, but it was perhaps exactly what needed to happen in that case. And not only did it have that conclusion, but it also taught folks like me who are focused on having more of these kind of necessity defense trials, it taught me exactly what we're missing and exactly what the line is of how we can be able to do this better in the future. And yeah. And so what it came down to, as I said, was that fourth point of the necessity defense about a lack of reasonable legal alternatives. And what happened in that argument there before the court was the judge was referring to all these other ways of affecting change. And he said, you know, that you can get attention and get your message out and do all these other things through petitions, through press releases, through, you know, all these other means. And unless you're saying that those are all completely ineffective, then there's got to be these legal, reasonable alternatives, right? Because sure, this act of civil disobedience got a lot of attention, sure it had a big impact, which he was celebrating. He was celebrating that big impact. He would say, but, you know, certainly all these other efforts could have done that as well. And so he sort of presented civil disobedience as on the same plane and working towards the same purpose as any other kind of activism. And there was a little bit of a discussion there in the jury instruction part of the case that came down to the intent of the activists. And there was this debate between the prosecution and the judge and the defense about what the intent of the activists was. And the prosecution was saying, you know, their intent was to block a train, and the judge was saying that their intent was to get media attention for these threats from oil trains and from climate change. And there wasn't a clearly coherent case of what their intent actually was, or what the purpose of civil disobedience actually was, that distinguishes it from so many other forms of activism. And so that got me thinking about what it is that is actually unique about civil disobedience, what it does that all other forms of activism don't do, and why it's been so important to so many social movements. And the key point that I started focusing on, that I've actually been focusing on for a while, is the vulnerability that is inherent in civil disobedience. And I think what was missing from the trial this week was an understanding that the intent of civil disobedience is not just to commit a crime. The intent is not just to get media attention. The intent is not to get word out about something. The intent of civil disobedience is to arouse the conscience of a community in order to build the kind of public pressure that is necessary to resist the corporate control of our government. And the tool through which civil disobedience works towards that intent of arousing conscience is the tool of vulnerability. Because civil disobedience is inherently breaking a law and risks oneself before the power of the criminal justice system, and it often has an element of physical risk and physical vulnerability, like Abby being at the top of a tripod in front of a train, that vulnerability rattles people out of their everyday lives. It awakens people's conscience, because I believe there's something fundamental about people, something fundamental about our human nature, in which when we see someone else in a vulnerable position, particularly someone who puts themselves in a vulnerable position, we can't completely look away. There's a part of ourselves that cannot look away from this person who is in trouble and needs help. That it is embedded into who we are as people, that we feel called to look deeply at these people who need our help. And it's that power of vulnerability that can break through the lethargic apathy that is rampant in our consumer society. It's what rattles people out of all their other concerns with their job and their bills and their TV shows that they like and everything else that sort of numbs people to the threats and all the information about those threats that we face. And as all of us who are activists know, it's hard to get through to a lot of folks. And we can give them lots of information. We can knock on their door and try to talk to them. We can call them up and all these things. And still we have such an apathetic, disengaged society that cares more about consumerism than protecting future generations. And it's vulnerability that uniquely can break through that and can arouse people's conscience, as we saw happened this week with those jurors. That it was only because they were sort of forced to look at what was happening in this case, and they were forced to look at the vulnerability of the activists that were in front of them, that they were rattled out of their everyday apathy, and now they're going to be at Abby's next lobby day. And so I think that shows that these working within the system kind of actions are not completely detached from the civil disobedience actions that are outside the law, that they're intertwined, that they work together, that the civil disobedience arouses a conscience so that people can be more engaged in those democratic processes. And civil disobedience, unlike any of the safe legal ways of trying to raise awareness and safe legal forms of activism, with the possible exception of a hunger strike in which someone is willing to die, and in some cultures perhaps self-immolation, those are the only kind of legal actions that have the kind of vulnerability that civil disobedience has. So it actually does something entirely unique, and I think that speaks to that point of no reasonable legal alternatives. There are plenty of legal reasonable alternatives that can raise a little bit of awareness, that can educate some folks. There are no legal alternatives that do that work of arousing conscience, because civil disobedience is more than just an intellectual kind of activism. It's a spiritual kind of activism in which, through our vulnerability, we open up the most vulnerable parts of ourselves, which invites out that vulnerable part of others. And so what I learned this week is that even as we go through these court cases and we have to fight against all these legal technicalities, that we have to engage in that as a spiritual struggle. We have to engage in that making this spiritual argument about what it is fundamentally about people that can be awakened. And I think that's been kind of reinforcing for me, because a big part of the reason that I chose to go to divinity school a few years ago was I realized that we have reached the limit of what we can do as a movement without soul. That in order to move forward and make progress, that we need to be a movement that is grounded in our fundamental spirituality. We need to be a movement with spirit, and be willing to wade into that territory of not just the scientific facts of what we face with climate change, but the spiritual context of who we think we are as people and who we think we are as a society. And I think we got a lot closer to that this week. We got a lot of resources to be able to do that better in the future. And most of all, I think we got that that demand from this week. The demand from this week, I feel like, is that in order to move forward and in order to realize our full power in this movement, we have to come into it as full people, with our full selves, including our spiritual selves. And so with that, I'll wrap it up, and I think we'll be able to have lots of time for question and answer. And I thank you all for being here. Go ahead.
Hi, Tim. Two really quick things, if I can. Civil disobedience does work to inspire others, but it also works to shine a spotlight on the wrongdoing and shame. And I think there's value in that. But that's just me. I thought the judge was very creative in letting in testimony that he didn't think he could legally let in without it being, overturned and then sent back for another trial without any of that testimony. I think his strategy might have been to let in enough testimony to influence the jury, but not enough testimony to be official. And so he probably put some thought into what would happen if he, down the road. So I think it was creative on his part and intentional. You think that's a possibility?
That could be a possibility. I was just having that discussion today with my sister, who's an attorney, and who just moved to Bellingham recently. But first, I want to address the first thing you said there. Yeah, you said that civil disobedience also has power by shaming those in power, shaming the wrongdoers, and that there's value in that. There's value in that shame. And I don't know that I agree with that. I think it does a powerful thing by putting pressure on those in power. But that statement that there's value in shame, I think that's the main thing. An industry can't be shamed. A corporation doesn't have shame. Because a corporation doesn't have a soul, it doesn't have a conscience. It's not a person, which is why it shouldn't participate in our democracy. But this issue of shame, I think it's one of the most important things that I learned when I was in prison, was learning about shame. And whether or not shame has any healing power. Because if our prison system could be thought of to have a product, something that it produces, the product of prison is shame. That's what they manufacture. And I saw when I was in there a distinct difference between guilt for a mistake or guilt for an action, guilt for a repeated action, a constant action, and shame. Because guilt and regret and repentance and all those things, they are based on what one does and one's actions. Shame is about who one is, who somebody is. And where guilt says that was wrong, and repentance says I need to move away from that, I need to become a better person, and I need to do better than that in the future, Shame says, I'm a terrible person. And what I saw in prison was that when people had that kind of shame ingrained in them, they were taught to believe that they're never going to be a good person, that they can't do better than that. And shame was actually a huge impediment to changing one's behavior. It was almost the opposite of repentance in a lot of ways. So maybe that's just linguistics, and certainly, like, we need to be challenging those in power, and civil disobedience is a great way to do that and put pressure on them to change. But I don't think we should be shaming. And, you know, one of the things that I so appreciated about the way that the Delta Five presented themselves in their action and in the trial and in everything about their case was that they didn't try to shame anybody involved in this. And they invited the best out of everyone that they interacted with. You know, one of my favorite pieces of evidence in this trial was the picture of Abby at the top of the tripod and the cherry picker coming over with the cops in it, and Abby reaching out with a clipboard and a petition on it, asking the cops and the firefighters to sign her petition to Governor Inslee for no new fossil fuel infrastructure. She was literally inviting them to be better than they were being. And that's also something that there was kind of a founding principle of the Climate Disobedience Center. You know, the other folks that I started the Climate Disobedience Center with were all folks who were involved in the lobster boat blockade action, where Jay O'Hara and Ken Ward anchored a lobster boat in front of the Brayton Point coal-fired power plant and prevented a shipment of West Virginia coal from being delivered. And they were put on trial, and they were actually given permission to use the necessity defense, but they didn't get to do it because on the first day of their trial, the district attorney took over the prosecution of the case, dropped all the charges, and then came outside to the crowd that we had gathered and all the clergy and media and supporters and everything that we had out there and gave this big speech about how he was dropping the charges out of concern for all the children who would be impacted by climate change. And he said, there's been a serious failure of political leadership on this that necessitates this kind of action. And this was a little before the big climate march in New York in 2014, and he held up Bill McKibben's Rolling Stone article, and he said, I've been passing this around to all my staff, and I'm gonna be marching in New York in a couple weeks. And I was just standing there completely stunned that a district attorney would be doing this. You know, as a Unitarian, I don't believe that any group of people is inherently bad. But there are some groups that I have to remind myself that that's what I believe. And towards the top of that list is criminal prosecutors in the age of mass incarceration. And so to have a prosecutor come out and join our side in that bold way, when he was tasked with the job of being our opponent, like structurally he was supposed to be our opponent. He was supposed to be against us. And yet he came out and took this big step onto our side. And so I had to reflect on what it was that it would invite our supposed opponent to become our ally. And I think a big part of it was the way that Ken and Jay and everybody else associated with that action operated as they did it. Jay is a Quaker, and he talks a lot about his own call to conscience. And every time that he talked about taking that action, he talked about what he needed to do in order to be right with his own conscience. And so the battle lines that he drew with that action was a confrontation not between him and somebody else who's doing something bad. The battle lines that he drew was between himself and his own conscience, or between his actions and his conscience. And so I think he invited others into reflection on their own conscience, and into reflection on what they needed to do to be right with their own conscience. And so he did this very bold, confrontational, uncompromising action that put pressure on those in power, but it was a kind of pressure that invited the best out of them at the same time, that might have challenged their structural role, but invited out the best of their humanity, invited their humanity to supersede their structural legal role. And that's, so we started Climate Disobedience Center with the intent that that's the kind of action that we wanted to create more of. That's the kind of perspective and principles that we wanted to guide more civil disobedience in this movement that invites the best out of people rather than shaming them. Yeah, in the back.
Good stuff, Tim. Thank you very much. I think the second part of your talk about that very topic of civil disobedience and its role in reaching people at a level that cannot be reached any other way through the vulnerability of people and reaching people at the soul level. That, I think, is the most significant part of your talk, so I thank you for that. You didn't mention the idea of Jungian psychology, which talks about archetype. And, of course, Joseph Campbell talks about mythology and the archetype of the hero. And according to this school of thought, a hero archetype is the name, that's a name in language, for a part of all of us that you refer to, I believe you refer to as soul, that can be reached by these acts of vulnerability and this act of heroism. And I think there's a lot of good material there for all of us to read, to find that part of ourselves and to recognize that in other people when they do something beyond self-interest.
Well, I would say that is intentional that I didn't talk about hero archetypes. I've been called a hero a time or two. And what I've learned from that is that most of the time calling someone a hero is another way to say you're not one of us. You're not like us. And that calling someone a hero is a way of distancing them from a community. And Campbell kind of like celebrates that of the hero that is like the lonely hero. And we have that image a lot in our culture of like the lonely hero. And I think naming someone as a hero is a way of imposing loneliness on them. And I think that doesn't work for our struggle anymore. That might have worked for past struggles. But I think what we're facing now is so challenging, not just on a physical level, but challenging on an emotional and spiritual level, looking at the collapse of our world, that we can't afford to have lonely heroes anymore. We need to have people that are connected to communities and that are not just isolated and off on their own. Another question.
Hi. I was thrilled when you fouled up that auction. And I was thrilled when I heard you were going to be here. I live north, and my friend Sharon Abreu told me you were going to be here. I'm a teacher, and I don't think people who do what you do and what we do as teachers ever know the full reach of their actions. And so I just want you to know that it was partly, maybe even largely because of what you did, that at my age, I decided to go and study environmental law and policy so that I could understand better what's working against us. And so I have three more classes, and I'll have my master's in environmental law and policy. And it started with some of my friends here, like Deja and others, when we formed the Alliance for Democracy here. But I wanted to pick up on your vulnerability theme, or maybe it's the theme, but your point, and that is that I don't know how many people here were in the courtroom when Andrea Rogers Miller spoke on behalf of the 8 children. Are some of those children here? Okay. These children are vulnerable, and it was their vulnerability that helped the judge, Hollis R. Hill, in the municipal court, no, Superior Court of King County, to rule in favor of the fact that it is a necessity that we protect our climate for future generations. And Andrea argued on the basis of the public trust doctrine. And I have hope that by working on new laws and better policies that we can work within our system of laws somehow. I'm not as courageous as people who are willing to go on tripods and stop trains. I'll admit that. But I am eager to work on new policies and new laws to make the system work better for the vulnerable people. Thank you.
Thank you. And you know, and I've talked a few times this week in various interviews about the overlap between those kinds of strategies. And I think the way that they work towards one another, you know, you talked about working within our system to make it, working within our system, and we're trying to sort of work our system towards us, work our system towards where it needs to be. And I think those kind of cases that kind of expand the realm of our legal system, in my mind, work hand in hand with the kind of civil disobedience cases that expose the inadequacy of our current legal system and show the need for it to expand. In the back.
Hey, Tim, what's up? How are you? We kind of spoke about this earlier, but I have like two quick questions, and one of them actually has to do with systems. The first being, obviously, Monday is Martin Luther King's birthday. If you see any parallels as well as contrast between the tactics of then and the tactics available to us now, and then regarding systems, like what would your message be to, are these tactics available to, say, people of color? Because in a justice system where we see armed insurrectionists greeted by law enforcement with handshakes and Black Lives activists greeted with stormtroopers and SWAT teams, like, you know, what would your message be to those? And are those tactics really available, you know, to everyone? Because we've spoken and I'm ready to use some tactics myself, so.
Well, there's, I'd say, a lot of answers to that. I mean, first I would say that, you know, people of color are using these tactics all the time. And certainly they're getting differential treatment, but they're using them anyway. You know, and the Black Lives Matter movement is a great example of that, that are using those tactics, are getting a violent reaction from the police, and are continually doing it anyway to expose the injustice of the system, and are being powerful at it. And there's a willingness to sacrifice there. And, you know, the first thing you were saying there about the contrast between Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement and the kind of civil disobedience that's going on today, I would say the biggest contrast is the level of risk and the willingness to be truly vulnerable. I had a phone call this morning from a friend of mine that works for the Center of Biological Diversity, and he was out in Burns, Oregon, and he was about to go out to Malheur with his boss, Kieran Suckling, the executive director of the Center for Biological Diversity. And he said, we're gonna go out there and we're gonna make it clear that we're environmentalists. And he said, you know, we're thinking of, you know, we're gonna check out the scene and see what kind of reaction we get and that kind of thing. But we feel like not only environmentalists who care about public lands, but really all kinds of progressives who see the differential treatment that these people are getting, need to show up in some way out here. We can't just let this slide. We need to be willing to stand up against this, nonviolently stand up against this. And I said, you know, if the folks who led Freedom Summer in 1963 had somehow known beforehand that doing that campaign would get three of their activists killed and buried in a swamp, would they have done it anyway? Or would they have had would they have had any kind of argument that would have made sense beforehand to say, yeah, we know people could get killed doing this, but we think historically it's going to be important and it's going to be worth it to give our lives, or for other people in our movement to give their lives in order to turn the tides of history and resist this injustice. And more importantly, are there any leaders in the environmental movement and climate movement today who would be willing to go down that path with the possibility that lives could be lost? And I don't know that we need any like clear answers for that. But I think we need to be honest about risks that we face and risks that we don't. And if we're gonna go down that kind of path that might invite violent reaction from like the Bundy wackos, then we need to be doing a lot more kind of spiritual resiliency work to be in a position for that. A lot of activists in the civil rights movement, like freedom riders and things like that, they signed their wills before they got on the bus. And when I talked to Taylor this morning, I said, if you want to go down that path, you better sign your will first. And anybody that you want to walk down that path with you, you better have them sign a will and have it be that real for them of what they're willing to sacrifice here. So we're not at that point, but you know, as we see with the hateful, racist, bigoted rhetoric that is coming from half of our political system right now, we might not be that far off from it. For Judge Howard this week to say, I understand what's ethical, but the law says this thing, so I've got to stick with the law. You know, there weren't huge consequences to that, at least in an immediate sense. The Delta 5 ended up with fines of a few $100 a piece. But it's not that hard to imagine in the not too distant future that some of the presidential candidates that are on display right now could be passing some laws where it would have some very serious consequences for us to say, well, I've just got to do what the law says. I'm just following orders from the legal system that I'm a part of, even though I think they're morally wrong. It's not a very far trip down until we get to a very dark point on that road. So I think it's important to continually remember what social movements in our past have been willing to sacrifice and what it has looked like to stand up against injustice.
I wondered if you could say more about jury nullification. You said that the juries have much more power than they know, and it's not something a judge can tell them, but you can tell everybody in this room more about how juries can nullify, like the Dr. Kevorkian cases. Over and over again, Michigan jurors said, yeah, you did help people kill themselves, and you technically committed malpractice, but we're not going to convict you because they wanted to die anyway. That's an example of jury nullification. Thank you.
Yeah, so as I said, juries were created to be the most powerful part of the court process. And that's for a very basic reason. You know, the court is set up as an adversarial system. This was the state of Washington versus Brockway et al. So it's one side against the other in an adversarial position. And you know, so obviously the prosecutor represents the state in this adversarial battle here in the courtroom. But the judge also gets paid by the state, right? And if you had a game between the Seahawks and the Panthers, and the Panthers hired the ref, you wouldn't expect it's going to be a fair game, right? And that's so obvious and basic that it didn't escape the conscience of those who set up our legal system, which is why they didn't make the judge the ref They made citizens the ref. To the role of a jury is to protect our fellow citizens from the government. And as that system has evolved, judges and prosecutors have tried to concentrate power in their own hands, because it's been a long time since we had leaders that were revolutionaries in our political system. And as that has evolved, we've had leaders that are more and more afraid of the people, and afraid of citizens, and afraid of democracy, which is perhaps why Jefferson said every generation needs its own revolution, because as power gets more and more entrenched over decades and centuries, it gets more and more distant from the people. But jury nullification is a very old part of our common law that dates back to when we got our legal system from the English, and it actually originates with William Penn, the Quaker, where he had kind of the original jury nullification case where his jury refused to convict him despite the facts. And there's never like a clear statement from the jury that like, this is jury nullification. All they do is acquit when it's obvious that the facts meet the legal standards of what constitutes a crime. But there's a rich history of that, even in our own country, particularly with the Fugitive Slave Act of 1851 that required people in the North to all act as slave catchers. And when people violated that law, there were a lot of communities in the North that simply refused to convict on that law. And it's what undermined the moral legitimacy of that law, and why the Compromise of 1851 couldn't hold. And again, that happened with Prohibition, where a lot of communities just simply refused to enforce that law, regardless of how clear the facts of the case were. So juries can't actually nullify the law, so I don't think the term jury nullification is necessarily a good one. I think fully informed and empowered juries is a better way to think of it, because they're not nullifying the law, they're nullifying the application of the law in this case. I don't think juries are perfect, and there's certainly some negative history of jury nullification in this country as well, particularly in the South, where juries refuse to convict on lynching cases. But the interesting part of that history is that only about 2% of lynching cases ended up in front of a jury. And certainly in that 2%, plenty of juries failed to deliver justice. But in the other 98% of those cases, it was police, prosecutors, and judges that failed to deliver justice. And so I think the question becomes, do we trust authorities more than we trust our own communities? Are we willing to let communities actually have a say? So, I think that's an important thing for everybody to educate themselves on, to realize that we do have that power, and we don't actually have to follow a judge's instructions in the courtroom. In fact, when it really matters is when we most need to stand up against what a judge is telling us to do.
You know, I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts on how you could actually get that message to the jury that they do have that power.
There are some ways to try to get that across in the courtroom and during the trial, to remind people of their role to be fully empowered, to remind people why we have juries, and to continually be talking about their conscience and the value of their conscience, to make it clear that the conscience of juries is the difference between justice and legalism. that conscience is essential. So I think reinforcing that throughout the trial is a way to do that. And since I was so heavily restricted in my own trial, I did spend a lot of time thinking about kind of the subtle ways to get this across if you're not able to kind of say everything you want to openly. But I also think it has to happen before people become jurors. There has to be a broader civic education in this country about the power that we have, and so that when people show up on jury duty, it's not like they're hearing it for the first time. Because it's extremely hard to change somebody's mind once they're already in that system and they're sort of disoriented by, walking into this courthouse and having the judge in his robes and all of his authority, speaking to them in his patriarchal kind of way. To counteract that in that moment is very difficult. In my own case, people had been doing some public education about jury's rights well beforehand. We had had a reading group on the jury nullification book by Clay Conrad, and some folks from that reading group then started passing out pamphlets from the Fully Informed Jurors Association out front of the federal courthouse every time that there was a trial, just from anybody who happened to be walking by at the time when jurors were supposed to report for jury duty. And they'd been doing this for like 6 weeks or so before my trial. And so they were out there the first day my jurors were supposed to report. And then partway through the jury selection process, the judge and the prosecutor found out that one of the jurors had gotten one of these pamphlets from the Fully Informed Jurors Association. And the judge said, well, how many of you received this pamphlet before you walked in on the first day? And like 80% of the hands went up. And the prosecutor lost his mind. And we had to have a special meeting in the judge's chambers with the prosecution and my legal team and the judge. And it was the only time I saw the prosecution like really lose composure. He wanted to declare a mistrial and get a whole new jury pool. He was like shaking when he was reading this pamphlet, and he was saying this notion of voting your conscience, it's out in space. Rather than declare a mistrial, the judge called each potential juror one at a time into his chambers. And I was, my legal team was in there, the prosecution was in there, the juror was at the end of the long table with the judge at the other end, and the judge would say, now, you need to disregard everything that was on that pamphlet. You need to understand that it's not your job to decide what's right or wrong. Your job is to listen to what I say the law says, and you have to enforce it, even if you think it's morally wrong. Can you do that? Can you do what I ask you to do, even if you think it's morally wrong? And unless they said yes, they weren't on the jury. And I was sitting in the seat closest to the juror, and I watched one person after another say, yes, Your Honor, I'll do whatever you ask me to do, even if I think it's morally wrong. And I could tell that they meant it. And that moment was the greatest moment of clarity that I had throughout my entire process. I think it was also the moment that I decided to go to divinity school. Because I understood the power of conscience so clearly at that moment. I think I understood for the first time how some of the great atrocities in history could happen. How something like a Holocaust or a genocide could happen when people can so easily say, oh, it's not my job to decide what's right or wrong. I'll just follow orders even if I think they're morally wrong. I saw all these jurors who had never been in jury duty before, and they come into this big, huge federal courthouse that's all imposing, and they had two metal detectors to go through because they set up an extra one outside of the door of my courtroom. So they had two security screenings to go through, and then they come into this ornate courtroom with like the judge sitting way up above them, speaking down to them, and they were able to just buy into that and say, okay, it's not my job to decide what's right or wrong. And you know, and I saw how such atrocities could happen when people just let go of their own moral authority and let go of their own conscience. But at the same time, I saw that prosecutor flipping out. I saw a U.S. attorney who had the full power of the United States government behind him, absolutely terrified at the notion of citizens using their conscience. He was terrified that citizens thought they could use their conscience in exercising their civic duties. And so I saw this huge dichotomy hinging on the power of conscience, where when people let go of their conscience and let go of their own moral authority and the shared moral authority of their community, that any atrocity would be possible. But when people held on to their moral authority, had faith in their conscience, and then the shared moral authority of their communities, that there is no power structure that can't be impacted by that. And I saw that as a critical spiritual issue of whether or not we have faith in our moral authority.
Thank you. As we reclaim language and reframe industry's way of talking about these atrocities and use words like proposal instead of plan for their schemes, it struck me during the introduction that we could talk about mineral and gas wrongs instead of rights, and that this legal system is what we're calling into question, and that's just one more way to do that. And that's just an observation. The thing that I wanted to say here is whether someone has been at this for 7 days or 7 years or seven generations, it's important to recognize the people who have been here for thousands of years. And so I want to recognize today the Suquamish people and the Tulalip people and the Muckleshoot people and the Snoqualmie people and the Duwamish people and all the Coast Salish people who have experienced this now for many generations up and down the whole Salish Sea. And if you could speak to your organization's structural approach to civil disobedience and privilege, and how you're reaching out to the Black Lives Matter movement and to the Idle No More movement, and how all the climate movement and inequality movement and all these movements can align structurally in order to bring the power of all of us together for the change that we need. Thank you.
Well, thank you for that, and thank you for grounding us in where we are and in whose land we are on. In terms of your question of how we are reaching out to those movements, we're not in the Climate Disobedience Center. We go where we're invited. We're willing to go anywhere. We're willing to engage anywhere. But we don't think we're anybody's savior. If we're invited, we'll be there in a heartbeat. But frankly, those movements are kicking more ass than our movement is. And as long as that's the case, we're gonna learn as much as we can from those movements. We're going to pay attention. We're going to listen to them. We're going to show up every opportunity that we get. But we're showing up to learn. We think that our organization has a lot to offer to help the climate movement. But we think we have a lot to learn from movements of color that have been challenging power in much more fundamental ways for much longer than the climate movement has, and have been much more vulnerable than the climate movement has for a long time. I can come into a predominantly white Unitarian church full of climate activists and tell them that they need to be vulnerable and preach about the power of vulnerability. I'm not going to go into a predominantly people of color crowd and try to tell them about vulnerability. Because they know damn well about vulnerability. So I'm going to learn all the things that I can from those movements and try to instill those lessons as much as possible in our own. And if there's anything that those movements think that we can help them with, then we will be honored. We will be honored to show up and help.
I'm very impressed, Tim, with your witness to the necessity or the importance of spirituality in the movement. I'm impressed partly because as a peace activist from the 60s, that wasn't there except in the civil rights movement. In fact, there was, in many cases, open hostility to spirituality. Well, many people today say, I'm not religious, but they're very willing to listen and talk about that aspect of our lives. I'm curious why you think or how that has changed over the decades, and what people besides Dr. King in particular you found have been helpful to yourself and others who affirm the importance of spirituality in what we're doing.
Well, to the first part of that, of why that has changed, I don't think it has entirely. You know, there's still plenty of hostility towards spirituality and towards religion. You know, which is to be expected because lots of religion still has hostility towards justice and humanity. And as long as that's the case, there's a lot of trauma that's been caused by religion in our society, and a lot of healing that continues to need to be done between religious communities and everybody else. So, you know, I think it's a measured step forward that we're able to have these discussions a little more in the climate movement. And I have seen a lot of progress in that in the past few years. You know, I've been a part of a lot of faith in climate kind of gatherings and conferences and stuff like that. There is more interest there. And I can't speak for like the broader religious movement. What I've witnessed in a lot of the white progressive religious communities that I'm a part of, like Unitarians and Quakers and UCC folks, is that there was a generation before us, like primarily the baby boomer generation, that I feel like largely grew up in oppressive religious situations. Like a lot of the baby boomers who are Unitarians that I see grew up in oppressive religious situations and escaped that, and are resistant and fearful of anything that leans too far towards those hostile religious communities that they grew up in, and a lot of the folks my age and younger that I see in Unitarian communities and stuff like that. Are oftentimes people who didn't grow up in conservative or oppressive religious environments. They grew up either in a liberal religious community or with no religion at all most of the time. And so there's a deep yearning there for something that they'd been lacking, particularly among people like me, I think, who grew up with no religion at all. There's a yearning for it. And there's not a trauma from it. So I think it's something that kind of comes in generational waves. And like I said, that's kind of for the narrow slice of folks that I have some insight into. One of the, probably the best theologian that I've discovered is a feminist moral ethicist from the 1980s named Beverly Harrison. And her work really resonated with me, and I feel like comes very much in line with a lot of the struggles that activist communities that I've been a part of are dealing with. And she wrote a piece called "The Power of Anger in the Work of Love," about how anger can be seen as an expression of love and used to get us more towards mutual and loving relationships. And, you know, I think throughout our social movement history, there's actually been a lot more religious grounding than we often give them credit for. You know, even people like Ida B. Wells was extremely religious and saw her work as being spiritual work and wrote a lot about that. W.B. Du Bois did as well. You know, so that's an element, I think, in a lot of those social movements that that we can learn a lot from and be inspired by as well.
How do you understand civil disobedience as not a a part of a spiritual element, not a duty, but simply as a tool in our toolkit?
I think that's certainly a perspective from which I look at it. I mean, I do lots of kinds of activism. It took like 4 hours of testimony for the Delta 5 to explain all the other kinds of activism that they do, and all the efforts that they make working within the legal system. So as I said, I think that false dichotomy between civil disobedience on one planet and legal actions within the system on another planet is unrealistic and not helpful, because they're intertwined. And I think they have to support one another. You know, I don't think civil disobedience as the only thing that's ever done would yield justice. But I don't think that legal efforts without civil disobedience would yield justice either. It's a tool that is appropriate in some situations, but not in others. But I think when it's only approached as a tool, something that we use, I don't think we use it as well as it could be used when it's understood as a spiritual practice. You know, like if you approach prayer as a tool to get something, it's not going to be nearly as powerful as if you approach it as a practice that is meant to change you. And I think we need to move towards looking at civil disobedience perhaps in the same way, as a practice that's meant to change us as much as it's meant to change our broader systems.
Thank you, Tim. I'm Sharon Abreu, and I come from the Pete Seeger School of Activism, which I'm very grateful for.
Are we going to sing right now?
Could if you want. Maybe later. Well, you know, I just want to say that so many things are just like, you know, flowing through my mind, and songs that are coming to mind, like Issei Barnwell's We Are the Ones We've Been Waiting For, you know, and Anne Feeney's Have You Been to Jail for Justice? And, you know, in the UU hymnal is Holly Near's We Are a Gentle, Angry People. Mm-hmm. And we are singing for our lives. And the thing that keeps coming up for me is this, the fear and the anger that we're hearing across the political spectrum. And how can we as activists, and, you know, in our civil disobedience and whatever kind of activism we're doing, really dig into those emotions of fear and anger that we're all feeling, you know? Because I think if people really allow themselves to deal with their anger a lot of times and work through the anger and let the tears come, we would have a much different society, and we don't let ourselves go there. And that's because it also speaks to the vulnerability that you were talking to, is letting the tears come and, you know, getting beyond the anger that's so destructive and so crippling. So I'd like to hear you speak to those emotions.
There was sort of a chapter of my activism where that was the main thing that I was talking about all the time, was these things that we are told are the negative emotions that we're not supposed to have, like anger and fear and sadness and despair. And I feel like the climate movement wastes a lot of energy trying to resist those emotions. And it's, first off, it's pretty destructive, because everybody that's feeling those things isn't sharing them, which means they're each thinking that there's something wrong with them and that they're crazy, or that they're bad activists because they're feeling this fear and anger and outrage and despair and sadness, and everybody else isn't, because they think everybody else isn't because they're not sharing it, when everybody's, you know, telling themselves that there must be something wrong with them. So I think that kind of cycle is extremely counterproductive. And I kind of resist the notion that those are negative emotions. You know, as I mentioned earlier, you know, one of the most impactful things for me was Beverly Harrison's explanation of how anger is intimately connected with love, that anger is a sign that something is wrong with one of our relationships. It's a sign that this relationship is not a mutual and loving relationship. But we can only be angry about the things that we care about. And so anger is also a sign that we care enough to bring that relationship back into a mutual and loving relationship. And that it can be used as that impetus to put us back on that path. It's not going to get us the whole way. But it can be honored and respected as that sign that we care enough to create mutual and loving relationships. You know, I think we can also find a lot of value in honoring our sadness and in honoring our fear, and in really grieving. And I think, you know, increasingly as we've passed the point and keep moving well past the point where it's too late to stop climate change, and it's too late for any amount of emissions reductions to prevent a fairly catastrophic level of climate impacts, grieving needs to become a core part of the work that we're doing. And in my own experience, grieving was a big part of what empowered me to take bolder actions then. And what I found was that when I kind of internalized the fact that it was too late to stop climate change, it did push me into a dark period for a while. And I did grieve for my own future. I grieved for the future of everyone that I cared about. I grieved for all that's currently being lost, and that's already been lost. And it felt like a process of letting go of a lot of what I was holding on to. And it felt like just sort of like dropping everything, which is scary to sort of drop everything that you're holding on to. But what I found when I did that was that I let go of a lot of things that I didn't need to be carrying. The things that I was clinging to, like my concerns about my own security and my financial welfare or my career or my reputation, and you know, all these things that were more burdens, really. And once I let go of those, I found myself with a lot more space to hold on to the things that I really did love and care about and the people that I loved and care about. And it was through that act of grieving that I ended up having a much deeper connection with my own gratitude as well, because it connected me in a deeper way towards all that I love. So I think we need to be willing to explore those emotions that we're too quick to label as negative emotions. You know, that we need to realize that we need to be able to bring our full selves into this work and into this movement, that the only way we're going to get done the job that we need to be getting done is with full people. And that means the full range of emotions.
Hi, Tim. I'm wondering if you could talk to us about a carbon tax and whether that would do us any good, or the idea of individuals buying carbon offsets so that they can lead a carbon neutral life? Is there anything in those topics that you'd like to talk to us about?
A carbon tax would do us good. It would be a positive thing. It would internalize some of the externalities that are distorting our economy and leading to an overconsumption of fossil fuels. So putting a price on those would be a good thing, particularly if it was done in a way that it could redistribute that wealth towards the things that need to be done to make our communities more resilient and address the wrongs that we have inflicted on communities in this country and around the world. So I think, you know, if it's done in that way, it's great. It's not going to be sufficient. In terms of individuals buying offsets, I don't think that's helpful, really. I mean, I think offsets in general are a scam, as somebody in the back said, and particularly when it comes to individuals buying offsets. You know, I think that money is much better going into community organizing and activism and, you know, all the groups that are fighting this struggle. You know, if you feel like you need to offset your emissions and give money, you should give it to a young activist who's struggling to pay rent while they're fighting for a livable world. So, you know, maybe there's some in the room that could help you out with that. next question.
I have a practice which I see is trying to change myself, and I'd like to hear your thoughts about it. The practice comes from an act of civil disobedience that I did about 20 years ago. This weekend is the 25th anniversary of the start of the Gulf War, and my act of civil disobedience was to take medicine to Iraq in violation of U.S. sanctions. Doing the act wasn't so difficult. Actually, even confronting the consequences was not so difficult. What I want to ask your thoughts about is the hard thing that still persists. Now, as I read Gandhi and King and study not necessarily civil disobedience, but nonviolence, I read Gandhi to say that it's really not nonviolence unless you wish well for the people that you're opposing. You wish well for everybody. That seems to me such a central and difficult challenge. And given what I've done, Mr. Cheney has become my model. And I mean this in due seriousness, even though when I've spoken about this to groups of people, I say we shouldn't demonize anyone, and people all shake their hands, yes, 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 shake their heads. And then I said, and that includes Dick Cheney. So I don't mean to make a joke of this. I'd like to hear your thoughts, because it seems to me that's an aspect of the spiritual perspective, whether it comes from religion or not, that I think the peace community in general doesn't do a very good job with. I'd like to hear your thoughts.
Dr. King talked about that in terms of agape, and he gave a lot of sermons where he distinguished a love in terms of loving your enemies is agape kind of love, which is not like, oh, you're so great, I love you so much. It's not affection. It's a recognition of the inherent worth and dignity of the person in front of you. It's loving someone as a child of God. And in terms of wishing your enemy well, I believe it was the Dalai Lama who talked about that and said, if I wished Hitler well, I would wish for him to die. And that wishing someone well doesn't mean that they continue to do what they're doing. That if someone is acting in an inhumane way, sympathy for them, loving them, recognizes that inhumanity that they're inflicting on others is destructive of their own soul as well. And recognizing that the best thing that you can do for this person is to stop them from inflicting inhumanity and injustice on others. And, you know, I think that's a challenging concept. And it's one that is, I find, difficult to understand, and far more difficult to practice. I have great respect for those who are further along on that path than I am. But I do believe in that. I do think they're right. I can't say that I fully wrap my mind around it yet. I hope that I get there, but it's an incredible challenge. I'll also say this, that I see far more liberals, especially, who fail to resist their enemy than those who fail to love their enemy. That far too often we err on the side of not standing up against that injustice. I think that's inherent in the teachings of Jesus as well, of turning the other cheek. I think that's often misinterpreted of like, turn the other cheek and just accept it. You know, turn the other cheek and walk away. But Jesus didn't say that. Jesus said, when your enemy strikes you on the cheek, turn the other cheek for him to strike as well. And that last part of for him to strike as well is a confrontational act. That's like when somebody hits you, you get back up in his face and you say, go ahead, do it again right here.
We have to get out.
Do it again.
Yeah.
That's a confrontation that is bold. And that challenges injustice rather than accepting injustice. I think it's a struggle on both sides. It's a struggle to love as much as we should be loving, and it's a struggle to resist as much as we should be resisting. Is there another question back there?
You know, we have a commitment to be out of the building at 9:00. So I think we really have to call it done at this point. So thank you, Tim. This was wonderful.
Thank you all. Thanks for coming tonight.